Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner. I am available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, I want to talk to you about C++ 23's assume attribute, kind of what compilers can do with it, and where it may or may not have some usefulness. Okay, so assume is an attribute that lets you give the compiler a hint about the nature of your code. This episode is sponsored by JetBrains. Besides yourself, who knows your project best? Your IDE. This is what makes AI Assistant and CLion, a C++ IDE by JetBrains, so context-aware and helpful. Wondering how to adopt C++ modules into your project or link to a selected library in CMake? Send your question to the AI chat. Its answer will take into account the technology you use and your project context. Need to research an error? AI Assistant and CLion can explain a runtime error, a CMake execution failure, or a selected piece of code. Want to improve your code? AI Assistant will suggest a refactoring and generate documentation for you. Learn more at jp.gg/cbp_AI. Okay, take this silly example here. We can see, well, this is an interesting particular example, that the compiler preloads both the input x, that is the RDI register, plus 10 and minus 10 into the EDX and the EAX registers, then does a comparison and it does a conditional move. So this code is highly optimized, but it's doing exactly what I told it to do. Depending on whether or not x is less than 5, it is going to return x plus 10 or x minus 10. Now, assume lets you give the compiler some sort of assumption. And I can say assume x equals 5, for example. And now the compiler is going to skip the entire body of this function because it's going to say assume x equals 5. Okay. So if x equals 5, and then I'm doing x minus 10, then I'm simply going to return x minus 5, because 5 minus 10 is negative 5. So that's the nature of assume. And I was increasingly dissatisfied with every example that I found of using assume. So I came up with my own. Because this is meaningless. Why would I even have the body of this function if I said assume x is equal to 5 here? Where it starts to become interesting and powerful is if I do something like this. Now note, I get the entire body of this function inlined here into main, but if I said argc equals 5 here, then I can see that main is simply going to return negative 5. That becomes interesting because there are certain assumptions that you can make. Let's change this and say if x is less than 1, for example, and we're going to say assume argc is greater than 0, because we know that we're never going to get zero parameters to main on any modern operating system. We're always going to at least get that argv of 0 is the name of the program. Now I'm going to go ahead and flip this around and show you the actual example that I created just for this episode. So I have this program that has this get value and it's expecting a pointer. And if the pointer is null, then it's going to throw an exception. If the pointer is not null, then it simply dereferences the value. And then I have forward declared this function called getPointer. So I don't know at compile time if I'm going to get a null or non-null pointer. Let's go ahead and comment this out. The compiler says, well, I have PTR on line 15. It may or may not be null. I'm going to pass that to getValue. GetValue has to do this check. So in main, I see the call to getPointer. I see the check to see if it is null or not. If it is not null, then I return the dereferenced value. If it is null, then I call this out of line code here that throws the exception, which, by the way, is an aside as to why exceptions are slow. It's because our compilers explicitly make them slow. Our compilers virtually always out of line and move to the cold portion of the binary, the exception handling code, because it assumes that we want exceptions to be slow. That's not always a good assumption. All right, so let's just say we have some sort of contract. I promise to never return a null pointer here. Just to be clear, I would say you probably want to be returning a reference in this case, but that could be a whole architectural discussion. Returning null pointers is almost always a bad practice and something that you should avoid. So let's just pretend like we have some sort of a contract and we can say, well, I want to assume that the pointer that was just given to me is not null. So I'm going to get the pointer, I'm going to assume it's not null, and then I am going to call get value with that value. And now we can see that main no longer has any of that potential exception throwing code in it. It simply calls get pointer and then does the dereference and returns that value back to the operating system. So there you have it. That is the idea of assume. And I see some potential use cases in this where you can, if you had contracts or other guarantees in your code that said, I know that this is never going to be X at this point, whatever that means, and then I can call a subsequent function, you might be able to hint to the compiler some optimizations that it could perform. Seems a little risky and dangerous in many cases, so you should definitely use this carefully. I'm not going to say anything about whether or not this is a best practice to use this, because I have not seen it used in the real world yet. And in fact, at this moment, GCC is the main compiler that actually supports this attribute for us to play with it. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed it and learned something new. Be sure to subscribe.